All right, so we're talking about questions for Go programming interviews, and I've put together a whole bunch of questions. And if you watched any of these other videos, you've checked them out. And I'm just gathering together good information for you to have when you're answering questions. If you want to check out these questions, you could go to GitHub Goes to 11. All the questions are there. Wait, no, they're there. and this is the code repo for my course, which you could access down here in the README. And you could also come to that class right there. It's this one here. And then the last thing I want to say is we were talking about value and pointer semantics. This is the outline for that course. I guess I'll put a link to it. I'll put a link to it in the description of this YouTube video down below. And here in this course outline, which is 157 pages long, you could search for semantics because we were just talking about value semantics and pointer semantics. And here are pointer and value semantics heuristics, so you could click on that. And then right now, you could just pause this video and you could read through that, like what are the different rules of thumbs we use for using value semantics or pointer semantics. And even if you just start talking about value semantics and pointer semantics in an interview, you're gonna see smiles start to arise, hopefully. Or maybe they're just gonna play their cards close to their chest to be stoic. But it's a good thing to definitely know about when you're working with the Go programming language. So in this video, what we're going to do is we're going to talk about these types in Go, built-in types, reference types, and user-defined structs. And so there's different ways we could categorize types. And again, it's good to know the language that we use to talk about the language. And this is engineering, so it's good to be specific with our terminology and to be able to talk to things directly. So in the previous video, we talked about the differences between declare and assign and initialize, which is to declare and assign, and then also to allocate memory, right? So understanding the differences between those terms. And so this one here could also be considered a beginner question. It could be considered a door closer. Because if you don't answer this well, you know, it's a potential door closer, but it's also an entryway for you to talk about more stuff. And so you could start talking about pretty much anything from here. And these are the different types, and Go is all about type. It's a type, statically typed language. And, you know, it's like, you know, it's a data-oriented language, right? So it has aspects of object-oriented programming. But thinking about it as a data-oriented language is a good way to think about it. So you can start talking about data-oriented language. You can start talking about how it's statically typed as opposed to dynamically typed and the implications of that and what the pluses and minuses to that. I think the pluses is greatly outweigh the minuses. And you could talk about programming idioms and idiomatic code. Right? You could go into all of those things. It's just pretty much, all questions in some ways are an open-ended question. So you definitely want to be specific about your answers, but also, you know, provide more information to let them know that you have more information. So explain these types in Go. Built-in type. The built-in types are the types that are built in the language. They're built in, they're ready to go. So that'd be like your numeric types, your string types, and then also bools. And I put all these down here in the notes. And so you could just control F through this document, but bool, numeric, and string types and error types, right? Those are your built-in types. Then we have reference types. And reference types are data structures that use references in some ways. So like a slice is a three-word data structure. And when I say word there, I'm referring to the word size on your computer. So anytime you hear me use a term that you don't understand, I want you to pause this video and I want you to go to ChatGPT and I want you to enter something like, you know, in computer science, you could just say in relation to the Go programming language, what is a word? Let's see what ChatGPT does with that. A word refers to natural size of data that a machine uses, right? So whether your architecture is 32-bit or 64-bit, the word size is like how many bytes, right? Or how many bits, sorry, how many bits does the machine process at one time? So 32-bit system processes four bytes at a time, 32 bits at a time, and we get 8 bytes on a 64-bit system. And so understanding that will help you talk about the language. So, you know, slices are a three-word data structure. So there's three words. The first word, then each word on a 64-bit machine or a 32-bit machine, the word size is on 32-bit, it's 32 bits. And on 64-bit, it's 64 bits. And so that's 4 bytes. or it's 8 bytes, right? And so a 3-word data structure, depending upon the machine, is either going to be 4 bytes on a 32-bit machine or 8 bytes on a 64-bit machine. And so slice is a 3-word data structure. And that first part of the data structure is a pointer to an underlying backing array. And then we have the length and we have the cap. And so it's a reference type because it's referencing some other data structure to work. So we have slices, maps, channels, pointers, interfaces, and functions. And then we also have structs, right? And structs are categorized as a different category because we, in this sort of way of thinking about how do we categorize the different types in Go, it's categorized as a different category because when we think about value semantics and pointer semantics, you know, for built-in types and reference types, as much as possible, we want to use value semantics. And then for structs, you know, passing data around and things like that, we have more flexibility, but always default as a general rule of thumb, keeping things simple, to using value semantics when, you know, and then you have locality, and everything is passed by value in Go. So even when you're passing a reference, wherever you pass it to is getting its own copy of that reference, and it could be a copy to the exact same memory location, but it's its own copy. So everything is passed by value. You pass it into a function, and it's like you assign that value to a new variable there, and it has its own scope. It's all passed by value. So you could start talking about pass by value and how everything is passed, all this stuff that I'm saying, right? You could talk about all this in relation to this question. So those are the built-in types, the reference types, and then the structs. And then I also just put down here two more categories for how we could categorize types. And so the primary way to think about types, the categories in Go for me is built-in types, reference types, and structs. And struct is a user-defined type, but user-defined types can also include not only structs, but interfaces, aliases, and functions. And so I just say structs here, but sometimes I also say user-defined types just out of habit. And then we also have composite types. And so composite is like, you know, composition is composing things together. These could also sometimes be referred to as aggregate types, right? And so there's some terminology, just getting precise with the language that we use to talk about the language. And the answer for the three, you know, those three different categories of types, we just went through them. So that's my answer for this question, and that's this question. And I will see you in the next video. Mm-hmm.